So there are different categories of the cyber stalking as of today. That means we're talking of 2024. And there would be a more type of the cyber stalking in the years to come, because this is a phenomena that will gradually grow over a period of time. Because with so many millions and billions of people coming onto the web, cyber stalking is here to stay, and it will only increase over a period of time. So one of them is a webcam jacking, where the name itself says that you are using the camera of a device to launch the attack, to do the cyber stalking. So intruder would attempt to trick the victim into downloading a malware, which will grant them the access to use the victim's webcam. So objective is to reach out to person and see his information, view him. And that can only be done if the victim's webcam is on. Then only you can see him, what he or she is doing in his office or in his residence or at his workplace. So what is the intruder or hacker trying to do? That he will trick you. That means he will send you a certain URL, or maybe ask you to visit certain website, or when you're doing online shopping, then he will send certain link. And knowingly or unknowingly, the victim will click on that link. And the moment the victim does it, a malware get downloaded onto his or her machine that will give the intruder the access to victim's webcam. So if such a kind of the cyber stalking is taking place, where the camera of the device is being used to do cyber stalking, we say it's a webcam jacking. Other very popular kind of the cyber stalking is the catfishing. It usually happens through various SMPs. SMPs are the social media platforms like Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, large number of social media platforms of Pinterest, where a stalker may counterfeit user profile, and nowadays very popular deep fake videos. Like we have seen the deep fake videos coming out of the movie stars, like Rashmika Mandanna's deep fake video was there. So many movie stars have their, even the abroad, many celebrities have reported that their deep fake videos have emerged in the market, in the industry. And it can be done just for the sake of fun. Why will the intruder do it? Point is that why will the user or intruder indulge in the catfishing? Primarily for the sake of fun. Just I want to do it. I want to show it to the world that yes, I have the potential to do it. I can pose certain challenge. Or I want to gain media attention, or I want to approach the victim as a companion and demand certain ransom for him. So I want to reach out to a person. I am in the need of money, and I will create a deep fake video. If the person come to know about him, then he or she will approach me, and then I will ask him to pay certain amount of money to him so that I can delete the deep fake video. Alternatively, the target can launch an official cyber complaint also. But most of the time, it is out of the court settlement that usually happens. And most of the time, celebrities don't want their name to get involved in these kind of activities. So they go for out of court settlement, and then they pay a certain amount of money, mutually agreeable money, to the intruder or the hacker. So these are two popular type of the cyber stalking. More of them are like, now there's a quid pro quo. Now what does that mean? The intruder or the attacker requests sensitive information from the victim in exchange for a desirable service. So he may plan to do such kind of stalking when he re will request certain sensitive information. Maybe like for example, he will pose that I'm a good maths tutor and your child is weak in maths, so I can offer him the tutoring classes at a very nominal rate because you are a celebrity and I'm a good fan of yours. So I am also in the same city as you are, and since I'm a good fan of yours, so I can offer maybe free coaching classes or a free tutoring classes or a classes at a very reasonable cost. So whatever kind of service industry I am in, if I'm an intruder or an attacker, I will ask him to, and once I start visiting his place, I will start seeing him more often, my target. So it's all being done in the exchange for the desirable service. So here I am teaching my celebrities kid, or maybe I'm a housekeeping staff at the celebrity's place, and I'm doing a mundane job of housekeeping for my celebrity. So means I'm trying to reach out to the person to whom I admire a lot, about whom I'm passionate a lot. Other kind of cyber stalking could be the honey trap. It specifically targets individuals looking for love on the online dating websites or on the different social media platforms. So most of the times, like the person from the defense, like the Air Force or the Navy or the Indian Army or more CRPF, various kind of defense forces are there. They, the enemies of the neighboring countries, try to honey trap them up. They buy means of certain amount of money or luring certain amount of that information to them in exchange of any kind of thing. Means the honey trap is a broad word where we try to expose the weakness of a person. So if I would identify who my target is and what is his weakness. The person's weakness could be the money, the gold, the diamond. Maybe he wants to go on a family visit abroad and he doesn't have money. I will arrange his family trip abroad, stay in a good luxury hotels, playing online casinos. So any kind of thing can be there. But the honey trap is you try to exploit the weakness of the target and use it for your own purpose. And what will the criminal do in this case? The criminal befriends the victim by creating a fictional persona identity and setting up a fake online profile. So most of the time, like the FBI is there, CIA, RGB, Mossad, RAW, IB, various kinds of intelligence agencies, they indulge into these activities. They set up the, they identify who their target is, what is his or her weakness, and then they will exploit that weakness by laying a trap for him. And if the person, and 9 out of 10 times, since the person is also a human being, he will have one or the other weakness and slowly he might get trapped into the process. So success rate of the honey trap is very, very high. That is what the service shows on the web. Another kind of the cyber stalking, very popular, is the Google Maps stalking. What happens in that? If a stalker detects victim's address, because nowadays many the addresses are visible on the social media platforms. And so maybe or through a friend, I come to know about the victim's address. Then I will be able to locate his area, where does he live, who are his neighbor, and what are his neighboring surroundings using the utilities like Street View. So using the social media platforms, the cyber stalker can locate the address of the target or the victim, what is his house number, block number, colony name, city name, neighborhood milestones, and he will try to reach out to the victim's location and then indulge in the offline stalking. That is migrating from the online stalking to the offline stalking. Other could be the geotags location tracking, because nowadays most of the time people upload their audios, videos, static images on the social media platforms like Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, Snapchat, and these have got their own latitude and longitudes, means where that particular location is located. And then using the geotag location, I can come to know about the exact location of the person where he's staying. And I can reach out there and then try to have the offline friendship from him rather than the online friendship from him. So most of the digital pictures contain geotags nowadays. And geotags usually follow the file format, like we have got a JPEG format, Joint Photographic Experts Group format. We have got an MPEG format, Motion Picture Experts Group. We have got a TIFF format, Tag Image File Format, TIFF. We have got also geotagged images, they have got an EXIF format, called Exchangeable Image File Format, which is usually embedded in an image and that can easily be read with the help of certain special type of the applications. And in this way, the stalker keeps an eye on the potential victim and fetches the information about his or her whereabout, that where his victim is located. Because using that image, I can decipher the information about his whereabouts, where he or she is located. Let us take an example to better understand it. For example, I've taken my own office room. So I can, we can see the room number. We can see the name of the person, his image, his own room. And since it is a geotagged, I can see the location at the footer of the image. So it's New Delhi, DL, India. Then the name of the road is Bhishma Road. CBD is the Central Business District, Shahadra, Delhi 32, DL, India. Then the lat and the long coordinates are there, latitude and the longitude, right up to the six places of decimal. Then the date and the time, whenever the image captured, the time is in GMT, that is Greenwich Mean Time, and the name of the device through which the image was captured. So all this information, the geotagged images, all this information usually comes. That what is the date, what is the time, what is the location, what is the latitude, what is the longitude. So lat and long coordinates can also reveal large amount of information about the individual. And also there are certain free of cost utilities, apps and website, which can also reveal more information about the device from which the image was captured. Let's say, for example, I give the same image to a website called metadata2go.com. Now what it will do, it will extract more information from that particular image. So this is the image information. If you can look at the file name rjroom.jpg, file size 133 KB, file type was JPEG, file extension was JPEG. MIME is a multi-purpose internet mail extension. This is again an image extension introduced first by the technical evangelist called Ned Borenstein. He introduced a MIME to the world for the very first time. Now, what is a MIME? It talks about the image and what is the type of the image. So if you look at the format of MIME, it talks of this is an image. It is not a text. It is not an audio. It is not a video. It's a static image. So a type becomes image. Then within that image, what is a type of that image? So the type is a JPEG, or it could be the bitmap file, BMP file, or it could be the XML file, .xml, or it could be the MPEG file, or it could be the TIFF file, tag image file format. So MIME tells that what is the type of the, what is the image, is it an image or a text? The first thing indicates the image. Then within image, what is the type of that image? So it's called JPEG type. Same way it would have been alt text. Is it text slash HTML? If it is a web page, or text slash doc, or text slash notepad, if it is a notepad file, the image text file, .txt file. So it will different, MIME type will indicate the type of the particular document. Then what is a JIF version 1.01? What is the resolution unit? The, since it is a free of cost website, it will not capture that. What is the resolution on X axis and Y axis? What is the width of the image? What is the height of the image? If the image has been encoded, then what is the encoding scheme that has been used? Now, there are a large number of the encoding scheme on the networks. Like we've got a LRC, longitudinal redundancy check technique, VRC, vertical redundancy check technique. So these are the error detection techniques. But there's a very good coding called Huffman coding, which is the error detection and correction encoding technique, which is one of the best techniques available in the worldwide for network. Then what was the data transfer rate, the bit per sample? It was 8 bit per sample. Then how many color combinations were used, color components? It was 3. So this is all the technical data which I'm fetching from the image, which may or may not help a cyber stalk to do the to launch the attack on the web. So metadata2.com is one of the sites. There are a large number of other open source sites also. If you want, you can open it on the on your own machine also, which will help you to extract the data from the image. And then the data can be used to launch the attack on the victim's device. And we might put the victim to download certain malware on his or her own machine. So that's another kind of the cyber stalking, where you call geotagged location cyber stalking. Another is another type of the cyber stalking, stalkerware. Now, what does stalkerware involves? It monitors the software that performs surveillance key functions. So it's a monitoring software. What it will do? It will do surveillance activities on your machine. What could be those activities, like key logging, usage of key logger onto your machine, making a screenshot, capturing the screenshot in the real time situations, monitoring of the web activity of yours, when you are logging in, when you are logging out, what you are doing on the web, everything will be monitored. Recording of locations, your real-time locations, your office space, where it is located, your residence, where it is located, and recording audio or video. So by installing certain spy cams or very small minuscule cameras in your office or your workplace or your home place or your near the gate of your house, the stalker will try to monitor your activities. At what time you're moving out from the house, what time you're coming in the house, who all are your friends on offline media or in the online media. He will keep on monitoring you. That's what we call the stalkerware. And these apps or these monitoring software have a capability to work in a stealth mode. Now, what is that stealth mode? Wherein user is never notified about that he's being monitored. That's something called incognito mode also nowadays. Earlier, it was called a stealth mode, where if you are watching certain activities of somebody, it is all being done in a very hidden form. Your target, your victim will not come to know about it, that you are doing such an operation on him or her. So it's called working in a stealth mode. And if this stalkerware is installed on the victim's device, then the application is not visible in the list of the installed program. So even if it is installed, it won't be visible to him. So when you come to the task manager, press Control Alt Del, it will show the list of running process. But the application like stalkerware runs in the stealth mode. So you won't come to know, okay, this application is also running onto your system. Because running application is usually disguised as a system process. So the victim or target, even though he has got a suspicious, he is doubtful that yes, he's being monitored by somebody on the web, in the cyberspace. And even if he tries to kill that application, the application is working in stealth mode. And the victim or the target will not come to know about it, that yes, his activities are continuously being monitored and being remotely shared with somebody on the web. So that's a very dangerous situation and it disturbs the peace of mind as well as disturb the privacy and security of the individual, who is a victim or a target. Now, there are a large number of popular stalkware apps if you see on the web. One of them is like Cerebrus. Another is a V-Curse. Third one is the Track My Phones, Android Lost, Overwatch. And these are almost on daily, if not daily, at least weekly statistics of this. That what are the number of active users by these stalkerwares. So stalkerware app, and now we're talking open source. There could be hundreds and thousands of the proprietary stalkerware apps, which can be bought on paid basis. So these are all, most of them are the freewares and they affect the users. And most of the time user are not aware about it, that yes, he's being monitored and somebody is continuously watching his activities. So a large number of stalkerware apps, which can be deadly, threatful, to the privacy and security of the individual. Now, after cyber stalking, there's another very important topic related to the cyber espionage, cyber bullying, rather in the large world of the social media platforms called as cyber grooming. Now, cyber stalking is usually happened to the adult individuals. Now, cyber grooming usually happened to the minors. So cyber grooming is a process of befriending. And now we are in cyber stalking, we are befriending an adult. But in cyber grooming, we are befriending a school kid. Means the person who are minor in age, a school going kid, especially in the age group of, let's say, 8 to 18. Means class 5th to class 12th student. And because nowadays so many online classes are happening, so kids have got their own laptops, they have got their own PDFs. They have got their own mobile phones. So they're also physically available on the web. They have also got their own email accounts. They have got their own social media accounts. So they're also very active users on the web. So cyber grooming is the process of befriending a young kid or an adolescent online. And what is the prima facie intention? What is a intruder or attacker doing? He wants to facilitate online sexual content and or a physical meeting with them, with the primary goal of committing certain sexual abuse later on. So my intention of the intruder or attacker in the cyber grooming is very clear, that I am not doing it for a cyber bullying. We are not indulging in cyber stalking. Here, intention is very, very clear, that I want to befriend somebody with a primary purpose. So purpose is very clear right in the very first stage. And who are the potential targets who become the victim of cyber grooming in today's age? It could be the emotionally unstable kids. Because most of the time kids come by the school by 2 p.m. or 2:30 p.m. And today, most of the time, parents are working. So we got something called DISC, double income, single kid. So child comes to the home and there is no one to look after him till evening. So he's all alone. And since nowadays mobile phones, and he has access to mobile phones, he has access to his laptop, so he can log into the social media platforms. And since there's nobody to guide him and he is lacking company, he does not have a brother or a sister, then he can be a system, very easy knave, a very vulnerable target to the intruder or attacker. And these kids, since they're all alone, most of the time they tend to become emotionally unstable. That is what we talk about, alone kids. The kids or the students who are all alone most of the time at home, because their parents usually reach home by 7 p.m. in the evening, and from 3 to 4 hours, they are usually left unattended. Nobody is there to guide them, to tell them what is right, what is wrong. And they usually accept the stranger's request on the social media platform. And stranger always befriends them by telling good jokes, making fun, making memes, cracking jokes, sharing online stories. There could be hundreds and thousands of reasons how these kids can easily be trapped by the intruder or the targets. Or they can be the kids of the broken marriages. So when the marriage is broken down, one of the spouse will get a custody of the kid. And if that spouse is working, he or she will not get much time to pay attention to the social, emotional needs of the kid or a child. And these childs become easy target, easy vulnerable points to these cyber grooming attacks of the intruders. Or maybe the orphans, because they don't have their parents. So there is nobody to tell them what is right, what is wrong. And they also become easy potential target of these cyber stalkers and cyber groomers who befriend them and then they later on exploit them to any possible extent, whatever they feel like doing it. So cyber grooming is another very criminal offense as per the definition of the cyber laws. And most of the time, the government gives advisories to schools, to colleges, that you sensitize the students that they should be very aware about who are the strangers on the web. They should not accept the friendly request from anybody on the web, because that could be an intruder or attacker who might pose a threat to your very existence on the cyberspace. Now, cyber grooming happens when the attacker or intruder befriends a child online and builds an emotional connection, because that's the very first way how you reach out to certain individual on the web. Means either you satisfy somebody's financial needs or you satisfy somebody's emotional needs. Now, emotional needs usually, emotional crisis usually happens when we have got a children of broken marriages, or when the divorce happens and the child is left all alone because of the judicial custody or the legal battle going on for the custody of the child. And child is left unattended. And he becomes very emotionally unstable because he's lacking, and because the parental love which should be provided at this age is missing. And he is looking out for that parental love, the emotion, the affection from the physical world or from the cyber world. Now, in the physical world, it's very difficult to fulfill in today's environment. Maybe in India around 20 years back or 30 years back, we used to have joint families. So we used to have our uncle, aunties, chachas, thais, mausi, mausas, buas, fufas, who used to be there as a good solid foundation to a family. And they can provide a good emotional healing touch. But nowadays, most of the time it's nuclear families, parents and their children. Not even grandparents become a part of the family nowadays. So children still need emotional satisfaction. They should be cajoled, they should be groomed, they should be guided. They should somebody should be there to laugh with them. Somebody should be there at home to play with them. And this is where interior attacker usually makes an entry. And they build the emotional connection, probably with the future intention of sexual abuse, sexual exploitation, or maybe later on with the child trafficking also. Because if you target your victim and you are able to convince the victim to come in the offline mode and meet him in cyber cafe or at any solitude location, then the child can be trafficked. He can be captured, he can be hijacked, and then he can be made to indulge in the child trafficking act. And intruders or perpetrators usually indulge in the cyber grooming. And what is the primary objective? To gain trust from the child. Means from where does the child cyber grooming start? First of all, they will try to gain the trust from a child that yes, they are a very good friend of him. They will crack jokes, share the memes, send certain good friendly audios or videos. And then they will try to gain the trust from a child initially. And the child is emotionally unstable. Or all left all alone, he is not attended by his parents, he has got a lot of free time, usually will spend a lot of time on the cyberspace, on the web, and these are the easily vulnerable target for the intruders. And what will the intruder or attacker do? He will try to obtain intimate and personal data from the child, because that is what his primary intention is in cyber grooming, not in cyber stalking, but in cyber grooming. And what kind of data we are talking of from the child? He will try to obtain the data which is primarily sexual in nature, such as he might involve him or her in performing sexual conversation. He might, the intruder or attacker might ask child, maybe he or she, it could be gender neutral, to share certain videos or pictures on online. And then they will use it to blackmail that particular child later on, or for obtaining the sexual flavors. So these are the threatful, these small things where child is not aware that what the intruder is asking him to do. And he might start doing it because that intruder has gained confidence in him. He has said that I'm a good friend of yours. You don't have a friend, but I'm a good friend of yours. And you can share all your things with me. And since the child is very emotionally unstable, there's no one to guide him or her at home. Parents are in the working state. The families are very nuclear in nature. Grandparents are not with him or her. So he doesn't know that he is doing something wrong. He will say, I'm just sharing this data with my friend, the online friend. And he's not able to distinguish what is right and what is wrong. So he might share all this information like pictures or videos. And then the intruder or the attacker might use it for blackmailing him or for obtaining any kind of the sexual favors. So that becomes a mindset of the intruder or attacker. What his initial intentions are, why he is indulging into cyber grooming. So they identify the target, they identify a victim, and then they will start obtaining the trust factor from the child. Because getting a trust is a primary thing. If the child become trustworthy, then he will share